Welcome to session two of this class. I'm Eric Wall. I teach music and oversee the worship life of the campus of Austin Presbyterian Theological Seminary in Austin, Texas. And I'm glad that we are together for this series of lectures and classes and introductions. This second class that we're doing this time, this week, we're focusing on definitions, defining the music that we use and planning for worship events. And so in this first part of the lecture of this evening's class, I will talk some about different kinds of songs, different forms and styles of songs, and some of the factors that lead us to make choices in one direction or another, or more fully a multiplicity of choices. We'll begin with this bit of scripture from the third chapter of Colossians, the third chapter, verses 12 to 17. And we will offer this as a way of framing our discussion. From Colossians 3. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you are called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom, and with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So this session, as I said, will consider congregational singing in the context of worship, and in particular, we'll consider the kinds of songs we sing. And as a preface to talking about that, we might ask this question. What happens when people sing together? When the community gathers and a group of people come together and sing, what's going on? Well, at the most basic level, what is necessary for people to sing? We have to breathe. We have to listen to each other and to other musical sounds that are happening. And we have to commit to a common activity, to a common purpose. Our singing causes us even to vibrate together, for the whole room to be on a kind of sonic current. What do we believe is happening theologically or spiritually when we sing together? I think several things, and you can add to this. Think about how you would add to this. I think our breath can be understood somehow to be a part of the breath of the Holy Spirit. We know that the Hebrew for spirit is ruach, which means wind or breath. And that breath that we are constantly inhaling and releasing, might be thought of as part of that Holy Spirit breath that is holding this room, this gathering together. We are also praying together. We are encouraging one another. We're giving witness. We're telling a story. We're strengthening each other. We're encouraging each other. We believe that the song, all the songs in worship that we sing, as the scripture we hear, as the sermons we hear, we believe that the song may be an encounter, somehow meeting God, somehow being filled with the Spirit. We often hear music in worship described in connective ways, and you may have used these terms. I find that I use these terms quite a lot. When people sing together, they join their voices. Sometimes we say that music is the glue that holds a service together. Sometimes we say it is the thing that knits up the community, the thing that weaves among the elements of the service, something that bridges the gaps or helps connect us from one place to the other. This connectivity is not just between parts of the service, though it may be like a song that connects the sermon to another piece of the liturgy. At a deeper level, it really is about the connections in the gathered community, the connections between people, the connections, say, between a choir and the remainder of the congregation, the connections between a solo song leader and the congregation, between a pianist or an organist or a praise team and the congregation, but most fully and most deeply, the connections between all the people gathered there. When we sing together, we are joining voices and breath and intentionality into something that is bigger than any of us could ever do by ourselves. In a song, we are sharing the same words, we are making a common sound, and that common sound is not the same as saying that all voices are the same kinds of voices, which we all of us, you and me and our work, we know this well. Everybody's voice is different. We know that in choirs and ensembles, we need all of those voices, as different as they are, as particular as they are. So the common sound is not necessarily everybody making the same sound. It's the sound of a common purpose and a common commitment. We commit to singing together, and therefore we welcome, invite, and encourage one another. One verse comes to mind here in that regard from 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, the 11th verse. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up as indeed you are doing. This common activity of singing, this common sound, this common breath may be pulling at us deeply in our inner being. Music, as we know, is a wordless art. We connect words to it in worship, but that deep wordless piece of music is pulling at us at deep levels. Singing for many people is a risky thing. It involves some vulnerability. Some of that is because people, not everybody in a congregation considers themselves musical or a singer. And you have probably heard people say, oh, I'm no singer, or you don't want me in your choir. Those are the feelings people have about their own voices, which it is our job to work to overcome, to break down those senses that some people can and some people can't sing. But because people can feel like that, for them, singing can feel like a risk. It can be a vulnerable thing. That risk or that vulnerability in singing can also be an emotional or spiritual thing. Songs tap into memories and emotions and sometimes wounds, sometimes deep history. And it is why the community singing is so important, because we have all had the experience of not being able to sing for ourselves. We're caught, words catch in our throat for some reason, and we rely on the people around us, to our right, to our left, in front of us, behind us, to carry the song and to carry us along with the song. So when some voices fail, when some voices can't take part, other voices come to the assistance. And that is why the collective community is the key part of any music in the church. So what does this have to do with the kinds of songs we sing? Well, I think at least in this way, if our songs are helping to enable people to pray and helping to enable them to create community, then a lot is at stake in both of those. So it brings to mind for me this question. Can a diverse community sing its prayers if only one kind of song is offered to them? Different people may need different kinds of songs, and I think all of us in our work find this to be true. You would answer that question and explore that differently in your individual settings than I would, and it's one of the reasons I love the fact that in this class we're called learners and learning partners, because we all take and receive from each other. But because different people may need different kinds of songs, it is why the kinds of songs we sing are so important. Let's talk about a few basic song types, a few categories or forms of songs. This will not all be new information to any of you, but sometimes it's helpful just to pull back and remind ourselves. A few basic song types. We might start with the idea of a song with verses or with stanzas. This is what we might think of as a regular hymn or a typical hymn. The kind of song where we sing a tune from the beginning to the end and then go back and start over on the same tune, but with a different set of words. And there could be two or three or four or eight verses to the song. A song like a hymn like Holy, Holy, Holy takes us through one set of one tune of music. start over for the second verse, and so forth. So the repetition of verses to a common tune, song with stanza. By contrast, we might say in the other end of the spectrum, a song that we might call a chorus. And these kinds of songs have different names, as you well know. We might call it a chorus, we might call it a praise chorus, we might call it a chant. Some books or song leaders will call them short songs. All of those describe in different ways what this kind of music does. Instead of multiple stanzas of words, usually a chorus, a short song, will have a short set of words that simply repeats. And because the words are shorter and repeating, the music is also shorter and usually simpler. So these songs are small scale, and they tend to have one fundamental difference from songs that are multiple stanzas, and that is that they may not have a definite time frame in mind. They're open-ended and flexible. We don't always know how many times we're going to repeat them. I can remember in a choir rehearsal early in a church that I served saying to the choir before worship that we were going to do a Taizé chorus, a chorus from the Taizé community in France, choruses that are designed to be repeated over and over. And somebody in the pre-worship warm-up asked, well, how many times are we going to do it? And I said, I don't know. And this caused a little bit of anxiety because we tend to be used, if we're musicians, to rehearsing. Often we can be used to simply knowing exactly when something's going to begin and when it's going to end, to give ourselves to an open-ended song in worship, not knowing how long it may last, which calls on us to be aware of the moment and how people are singing and what the energy in the room is and the movement of the spirit in the room is. That's a different matter. So these songs offer us that flexibility because they're simpler and shorter. So these come from all parts of the world and all kinds of traditions. This is one, in English, Know That God Is Good. This comes from Central Africa, Mungu Nimweba. And as you're looking at this on your screen, you will see what looks like three stanzas. It's really two in English, Know That God Is Good, and then a follow-up of Hallelujah. But this short little song, though there are no repeat marks in the music, is designed simply to be sung as many times as needed. So we would sing, Know that God is good, know that God is good, know that God is good, God is good, God is good, know that God is good, know that God is good, know that God is good, God is good, God is good. And we might repeat it however long we need, depending on what it's doing in the service. Short song, simple repetition. That's the kind of the other end of the spectrum from songs that have stanzas versus songs that are choruses. Now, somewhere in the middle, we can find other forms of songs. One might be thought of as a song that has both stanzas and a refrain. This really is a song that's a little bit of both, and we know many of these as well. You kind of get the best of both worlds in some ways, because in songs like this, you get different stanzas that keep repeating, that don't repeat. You have different stanzas that give you perhaps a line about God the Father, a line about God Jesus Christ, a line about God the Holy Spirit. But in addition to those separate and changing stanzas, you might also have a refrain that is the repeating element, so that you can both cycle through different stanzas, but have the constant unchanging quality of the refrain. And so the song feels repetitious and reliable in the refrain, even while the words of the stanzas are changing. And these have been around for years and years and even centuries. And these are often the songs that historically have been for people who were not expected always even to sing the stanzas, maybe for communities that learned only by rote or only by hearing rather than learning by reading, or stanzas or songs that are designed for different kinds of musical relationships in a congregation. One of the most classic that comes to mind would be the hymn Blessed Assurance, where we get stanzas Which is always the same, no matter the changing stanza. So songs with stanzas and choruses, kind of a middle ground between songs only with stanzas and songs that are only choruses. That's three ways of categorizing songs, but there are other ways of thinking of different kinds of songs. We think of songs in different musical styles, sometimes in different genres based on harmony, rhythm, and instrumentation. So songs that we might think of more as related to classical music, songs more related to pop music, or rock music, or other kinds of genres that we hear in everyday life. We think of certain labels of different kinds of songs, such as traditional, contemporary, spirituals, carols, folk songs. Also, we think of global songs. One of the challenges, I think, with thinking of global songs now more than ever is to make sure that we think about them knowing that we ourselves are located globally. So really, all music is global music. Any song is a global song. It just depends where you are on the globe. The songs that we in the United States love the most would be global songs to another part of the world, and songs from other parts of the world might be thought of as global to us here in this our part of the world. So the gifts from the global church have been one of the most astonishing group of songs in the past several decades to us. So if we were thinking of different kinds of songs in these categories, we know that even if we hear them back to back, we hear different flavors, different musical flavors. So a contemporary song might be something like Sanctuary. As we want. This is both a contemporary song and a chorus. Lord, we a song in the spiritual category might be one of any number. This that you see before you comes out of the current Presbyterian hymnal, this arrangement of I Want Jesus to Walk With Me. We might think of carols as a different category of song. And it's an interesting category because they come from over a span of hundreds of years. Some categories have a relatively confined time frame. So what we call contemporary songs, for example, might be songs only in the past 40, 50, 60 years, something like that. Whereas carols are something that come over hundreds of years, Joy to the World being an example of one where text and music come from two different time frames. We might think of another category as folk song. Here we have one of the most famous of kind of folk hymns, I Dance in the Morning, or sometimes called simply Lord of the Dance. It's a folk-like text about the story of the life of Jesus, and it's a famous folk tune called Simple Gifts. And it gives us a whole different flavor. Energetic, buoyant nature of folk music. And in terms of global songs, we have already heard in this lecture, Mungu ni Mwema, know that God is good. So genres of music is another way to categorize songs. Still another way is to categorize songs based on the kinds of instruments that are playing. You and I face these questions every time we lead worship. Who's going to play for this song and what are the instruments? And those are questions of what the instruments are that we have available in the room, and also who are the people we have to play those, and where are the gifts in this community that can contribute instrumental sound. So is a song accompanied by the organ, or the piano, or the guitar? Is it accompanied only by percussion? Is it accompanied maybe by some combination of these, a band or a praise team? Are there other instruments? Often there are high schoolers or other members of our congregations who are band members and contribute to melodic lines or other kinds of portions of songs. And of course, the question we should never forget in accompanying songs is the occasional reminder that sometimes songs need no accompaniment, that sometimes we just stop playing and let the people do their singing. I was playing for a song this morning in worship that had 6 or 7 verses, and about halfway through, people were singing so strongly that I just kind of took the organ sound down quietly and then stopped playing for 2 whole stanzas, and people kept going just fine. So occasionally, as we're thinking about the differences in song accompaniment, we need to remember that no accompaniment is often an option too. And often people will sing most strongly when there are no instruments around them, which can be counterintuitive to us, that we think as musicians that our support is often crucial, and it often is crucial, but when people sing without it, they often find their voices in different ways. They learn to hear each other and to rely on each other. So we should never forget that as an option. Still, another way we might think of categorizing songs are based on the ways a congregation receives the song. So in some traditions, a congregation may sing from a hymnal, some kind of a hymn book or a song book, whether that's published by a denomination or a publishing house. Some churches assemble their own songbooks and kind of publish them in-house. Sometimes songs are not printed in a hymn book, but may be printed in a bulletin or an order of service. Sometimes songs are projected on a screen. And sometimes songs are simply learned. They're learned by rote, they're echoed, a song leader sings, and we respond. And the reason why this can be a helpful category of kinds of songs is that it changes the way songs are sung by how the congregation sees or doesn't see them. So if we are singing in worship and we're singing from a book, our heads may be down, hope you can see this, our heads may be down looking at the book. If we're singing from a screen, we're all looking up in one way. That can change how sound comes into the room. If we're singing without anything in our hands, it frees our hands for clapping. It may free our bodies for moving. It also can change the way the song acts as a prayer for us, or the way we can consider the text. If we sing from a screen, our voices and our eyes are freed into the room, but a possible disadvantage is that we only get to see one set of words at a time. If we sing from a book, a possible disadvantage is that our head may be down more than it is up, but a possible advantage is that we can see all of the words before us. We can look at the words ahead of time. We can go back and look at them later. It's something to hold on to. So it's not that one way is right and one way is wrong. It's simply that these different ways of singing carry with them implications for how we experience the song. And you know this well, that how we experience a song on paper is different, not better or worse, just different than how we experience a song on a screen or a song where we see no words at all, but we are simply relying on a song leader, and that's a person whose voice we echo, or a person who teaches us the song. So all of these ways are different ways we can categorize songs. So just to review, the way songs are structured, verses or choruses or some combination of verses and refrain, the way songs are accompanied, the kinds of musical genres that we find, folk or contemporary or traditional, or gifts from the global church, the ways we actually sing songs in worship, how we have the music or the words in front of us in a book or a screen or neither one. Those are all different ways of how songs are functioning and working in worship. And each of those ways has implications in how we experience the song and how the song enables people to pray and to worship and to offer praise. What are some other implications for these kinds of songs? We might think of these as a series of questions. And again, as before, let these questions spur you to think of your own questions. But some questions. Can everyone in the room read? Little children can't read all the words that are in books, and people who have vision impairment may not be able to read them easily, or even at all. Is everyone in the room an adult? Is the language and music of all our songs presume an adult mind, an adult knowledge of vocabulary, more adult theological ideas, or a really intricate familiarity with the Bible or with church language? Children need simpler songs, and do our songs give them a way to sing as well? Does everyone know the song? We can easily pick the songs that are our favorites as music leaders, or the favorites of the choir or the band that we lead. We can pick songs that we think are known by the entire community, but nearly always there may be somebody in that community who doesn't know the song that we think is familiar. Is the song for everyone to sing, or is it something that's more doable only by a select group of musicians? It's not that a choir or a band shouldn't do particular music. They should. That's a stewarding of the gifts they bring and the faithfulness of rehearsals that they bring. But if all of our songs are mostly doable only by musicians and people who have practiced for a while, and not doable on the spot by the entire congregation, not intended to be sung by the whole congregation, the congregation can end up feeling left behind if the song doesn't have a tune or a text or a familiarity or a welcome that enables them to participate. Does a song allow people to move? And here this could mean, does the song give us hands free for clapping? Does the song invite our physical involvement, not just our vocal involvement? And does the song maybe allow us to move in the space, to sing while we move forward to take communion, to sing as we come into the room for worship, or to sing as we go out of worship into the world? This next question might seem like an obvious one, but it's one we have to keep asking ourselves. Does this song fit the service? It may be a song I really love, or that my choir really loves, or that my musicians in the band really love, but the song might not work so well in this particular service. What is surrounding the song? What's the framework of the song? What is it relating to? Will it be obvious to people when the time comes for this song that it connects either with what came before it or with what is going to come after it? And do songs consider who is here in the room or who might not be here in the room? One way of asking that for me is, do we sound only like the church that we are, or can we also sound or attempt to sound like the church we would like to be? And we'll expand on that question later in this, as we go through this lecture and through this class. So a few songs just to take a little further forward what we've been talking about from some different types and some different origins. Here is a lovely song from South Africa. Come bring your burdens to God. Woza nomthwalo wako. So this is a song, if we look at it, we can see clearly would fall under the repeating chorus category. There's only one verse of text here, both in English and in its original language. And so it's designed for repeated singing. So we might ask ourselves questions about this song based on the context and the time we're going to sing it. So let's listen to it first. Very easy to sing, very easy to pick up. What are the questions we might ask about this song? We might ask questions of when is it going to be used in worship? And that might influence us into how many times we repeat this song. This song can often work well when we're doing a prayer of confession. So if we were going to sing it, we might ask, are we singing this before a confession prayer or after one? That might change the number of times that we sing the song. We might ask whether we're going to accompany this song or not. These chords are fairly straightforward. This song is easy to get into your ear, into your mind, and to sing. So we might ask a question, are we going to accompany this all the way through? Maybe we just begin it with accompaniment from instruments of some kind, and then as the people gradually become more confident, we pull the instruments out and let the singing be unaccompanied. You will notice that there's a small line for, it's kind of a descant, but it's also a line in which the song leader can indicate to the people that the song is going to continue. So I will play the congregational part and sing the descant part. That final measure, as you can see, is really a kind of a cue for the congregation that we're going to go back and sing it again. So the song leader there has a real function, and that's a decision we might make and a question to ask beforehand. We might ask, how fast or slow is this going to be done? If this is done as a lead-in to prayer, it might be done in a very devotional, quiet way. Inviting people to be centered and still. And if we do it at a really slow tempo, we may need to repeat it fewer times. If it came after a prayer of confession, where we're moving in the prayer towards an assurance of God's forgiveness, we might sing it at a slightly quicker tempo, reflecting the acknowledgement of that grace of God. So that there's some confidence in God's grace that is illustrated through the way we sing it. We might need to decide what key we're going to sing this in, which could be based on songs that came before or songs that came after. So even though it's printed in this key, because the song is in a fairly low range, it has some room to move. Even as high as F. Thank you. of course, as you know, the character of the song will change if the key changes. And so our choices of key may be both what is doable for the musicians we have, how the song relates to what came before it or what comes after it, or the kind of expressive feeling that we want the song to have, or some combination of those. So right away with one song, we see that all the factors that are involved, those choices get really, there are many combinations of the choices. Let's look at a couple of other songs here. If we consider a hymn in the opposite direction, like Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, this one would be a kind of classic hymn in stanzas, three stanzas in this case. Now this song we just happened to sing this morning at the church I was playing the organ for, and I realized I had to make a couple of choices about this. We were only singing one stanza. We were singing it as the response to the prayer of confession. Prior to this song, we had a Kyrie, Lord Have Mercy. Now, in the bulletin from which we were singing, the Kyrie was printed in this key. And in the hymn book, Come Thou Fount is in this key. But because they came so close together in the worship service, I was trying to find a way for them to seem like they were all part of the same overall prayer. So we split the difference on the keys. We moved the Kyrie down from here, from F major to E flat, and sang it lower than we normally would. And we moved Come Thou Fount up a bit from here in D to here in E flat. And that meant that we could have both songs in the same key. So part of the decision-making there for me was based on what the song was relating to that had just preceded it. Now here on Come Thou Fount, we might make a decision on how fast we sing it. A hymn like this can have a really vibrant, energetic feel. Elect to do it a little bit more gently and more like a folk song. We might play the harmony right out of the hymn book. Or if we have guitars or other instruments that give drones or different kinds of chords, we might change the harmony a bit so that it rides on a current, a different kind of harmonic current. So little nuances like that. It's the beauty of folk music that you can mess around with it and it will still have beauty and character and integrity to itself. And all those choices are based on how the song is going to work. And of course, in all of these choices, in fact, really the most critical, it's the alpha and the omega of the questions, is in all of our choices, what enables people to sing? We can make exciting musical decisions with instruments that leave people's voices behind. So we might choose a tempo that feels really expressively beautifully slow or really energetically alive because it's fast, but we might leave people behind because they either it's too slow for them to sing or it's too fast for them to sing and they can't even find a way to breathe. So all of our decisions ultimately have to start with and end with what enables the people's voices to take part in this, so that we are not merely leading the song as though we were in a different room and the people are kind of along for the ride. Our decisions are all being made so that we lift up their voices, so that our work as song leaders is carrying their voices, enabling their singing, which really is enabling their prayer. Because all this work that we do for song and worship is for the praise of God and for the prayers we make to God. So those are the key decisions that we face. It is why we started this part of the lecture with that Colossians text. Above all, clothe yourselves with love. All of our decisions about singing are ultimately decisions of love. Love for the people in the chairs and pews of our worshiping spaces, and a love for the God who created song and created our voices to join in that song. So our songs of tempo, our choices of tempo, our choices of category, our choices of instrument, our choices of key, our choices of words are all made in a spirit of love, so that people may offer this song with as much confidence, despite their fear of their own voice, that they can be swept up and invited and welcomed into something that joins all the voices in the space. Our songs tell other people a lot about our church. And when people visit our church and they hear wonderful singing and they feel that this is singing they can take part in, then we've just offered great hospitality and great welcome. And we've sent a signal to people of the kind of community this is, one where everybody's voices are welcomed. It is finally a matter of trust. Do we trust that the Holy Spirit can use all of these songs, all of these categories, all of these instruments, all of these keys and tempos and genres of songs? Are they all usable by the Holy Spirit so that the worship of the people of God would have beauty and richness and authentic prayer? In the second part of the lecture that Dr. Leach will do, you will explore these issues more thoroughly, and you'll hear more about the assigned postings and the ongoing assignments. Thank you for your time in this first section of the lecture. As always in these lectures, if Dr. Leach or I can be of any help, don't hesitate to contact us through email, and we'll be as much help as we can be. Thank you for your time. It's good to be with you, and we'll see you in the next session.